Good afternoon, everybody, and you're very welcome to today's masterclass, double bass masterclass from the National Concert Hall. So while we can't obviously welcome you to the Concert Hall at the moment, we are nonetheless delighted to present this series of spring masterclasses, of which this is our second, and we're equally delighted to welcome the wonderful double bass player Aura Stone to the masterclass this afternoon, who will be working with three of Ireland's up and coming double bass players during the course of the afternoon. So just to explain a little bit about the structure of the afternoon, we will have two of our participants, each of whom will have approximately 40 minutes with Aura. And after that, we'll take a very short break, just about 3 minutes to stretch the legs, get some air. And then we will return with our third and final participant, after which we will have a short Q&A session. So during the masterclass, if you would be interested in asking a question to Aura on any aspect of this afternoon, or about the double bass, or about her orchestral and playing experience, please do so via the chat facilities in our social media channels. So on our YouTube channel or Facebook, we will relay them to Aura, and we will do our very best to answer all of those at the end of the session. So Aura, you are very, very welcome, and thank you for joining us this afternoon. So Aura was born in Yorkshire in England, and I started playing the double bass at the age of 9. Scholarship at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama, and she relocated to Dublin to join the RTE National Symphony Orchestra in 1996. She was subsequently appointed sub-principal double bass and held that position until 2016. She is now a sought-after freelance performer who enjoys a very varied and diverse freelance career, touring the world, performing concerts with the Irish Chamber Orchestra, the Ulster Orchestra, Camerata Ireland, RTE Concert Orchestra, and Wexford Festival Opera. Not only is Aura a hugely experienced performer, she is also a very experienced recording artist and has participated in multiple live broadcasts and film sessions, CD and TV recordings. She also has a very keen interest in chamber music. And she is also an enthusiastic teacher and educator. And in 2013, she co-founded Classical Kids, a concert series for babies and adults. This began in Dublin and rapidly expanded to include venues throughout the country. And I'm very happy to say that we have an ongoing relationship with Classical Kids, presenting child or baby friendly concerts in the National Concert Hall. And we hope, obviously, to be in a position to do those again very, very soon. Aura, you're very welcome. And we hope you enjoy this afternoon's session.
Thank you so much. Happy to be here.
Our first participant is Alex Fell, and Alex is in the final year of a Bachelor in Music Performance at the Royal Irish Academy of Music. He's studying with Seamus Doyle, and since 2019, he's played regularly as an extra with the RTE Concert Orchestra and Ulster Orchestra, and also he has an interest in historical performance practice, playing with various Baroque ensembles and taking part in the Irish Baroque Orchestra Mentoring Scheme. Alex, you're very, very welcome to this afternoon's masterclass, and we very much hope that you enjoy this session with Aura. So it's time for me to step out and sit back, and I'm going to enjoy the session. And Aura, I will leave you with Alex, and just don't forget, folks watching, to put any questions in the chat facilities during the session. And we will see you in about 40 minutes, Aura. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nigel. So hi, Alex. How's it going?
Hi, Aura.
Hi. Do you know what? I think maybe we'll start with the orchestral excerpt. Is that all right? Have you got that on your stand? So what are you playing?
The third movement of Beethoven 5.
Okay. And do you have the whole part there, or is it kind of condensed?
Yeah, the whole part.
The whole part, okay, brilliant. So do you know what? Let's just go at it. Do you want to just play it all the way through, and then we'll come back and have a chat?
Thank you.
I really enjoyed your strong rhythmic kind of pulse. It shows that hammer stroke at the beginning of the trio. Can you just play that on a C? It's really great. Yeah. Cool. Just play it on one note, just play it on a C. Yeah, it's really, really good. How do you feel about that piece? Do you like the symphony? Obviously, you've listened to it.
Playing or listening to it? I mean, yeah, I've played it a couple of times. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And this moment is fun.
Yeah, totes fun. And how I'm interested in how you feel the bass part fits into the whole thing. You know, it's difficult. Have you played it with an orchestra?
No. Yeah.
Well, you have. Yeah. So that sense of fitting in to the texture, you know, with everything else that's going on. How do you feel from that perspective?
I guess in the scherzo and the trio, there's kind of generally tend to start out as the main voice and then go into the background. Like the start of the trio, it's just the basses and cellos, and then, you know, it's a kind of vehicle thing. More people come in and we're less important.
Yeah. So what do you think are the most important elements then? So let's just focus on the trio for a sec, you know. What do you think is the most important things to be focusing on? What are you thinking about when you're playing that? What's going through your head?
Well, I'm trying to give some sense of the direction. There's a kind of a rising. There's like the smaller phrase of the first two bars, and then there's the general rising towards the middle. And also trying to play in tempo.
Yeah, actually, it's much easier to play in tempo when you're in an orchestra and you've got everybody around you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, my only criticism really, I thought your playing was fantastic, really great. There were just a couple of places where you kind of fell ahead a little bit. So I noticed, where was it? Towards the end, maybe it was the G octaves, everybody always rushes there.
Yeah, I kind of switched off at that point.
Yeah. Well, actually, that's interesting that you say you kind of switched off there, because it's easy, right? So, and you kind of go, oh, I made it, I got through. But actually, you have to kind of keep really, you have to keep really focused there, because it's really easy to come unstuck. And if you were in an audition situation and they let you play through to that point, they're expecting you to rush. So don't give them the satisfaction. So if you really, really kind of keep that rhythm bedded down, that would be great. Why don't we just do that? Where should we go from? Do you want to do the last little bit of the, just somewhere after the second time bar?
Yeah.
One of those fortes, and then go through into that G octave bit and just keep it really steady but rhythmic. Yeah, that was better, wasn't it? Didn't you feel more solid? Yeah. So dynamically, in that section, I mean, there's nothing really written in the part, but there's an insistence that's required, I think, from the bass players, you know, harmonically.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what do you think you could do dynamically that would convey that? Because obviously that G octave bit, it's not, you know, it's just, it's a pedal G. It's not, it needs to be present, but it's not of interest beyond that. Yeah, so it maybe doesn't need to be as loud. I mean, what dynamic, it's marked forte at the beginning of the trio, and there's what, nothing else.
Yeah.
Yeah, so so I think it's up to us as players of the section, as, you know, has a responsibility to be aware when we're important and when we're not.
Yeah. You know,
and when we still need to be present, but when we need to be kind of dominant. Yeah. But actually within that, it gives us that there isn't a whole load of dynamics. It gives us really tremendous scope to be musical and to make shapes and phrases, you know. I think you alluded to that earlier. You started to talk a little bit about that. Yeah. So from the beginning of the trio, tell me what you were thinking. What was your idea in terms of phrasing? Where are you going to, and how does it break up into parts?
Well, the first two bars of quavers are kind of going towards the high G.
Yeah.
And then from there, it's, you know, it's just a sequence going up. Then it goes back down, and it goes back up again, and the next time it's higher, and it goes back down again. So kind of just following the getting louder as it goes up. And
we'll go back to that in a second. And then when you get to the quavers, the moving quavers before the first time bar.
Yeah, then kind of crescendoing through those to the first time bar. Yeah.
Yeah, I think because that's repeated, it's really important to emphasize.
Yeah.
That those three bars. Would you just play those three bars before the first time bar? Yeah, the first beat actually is really important, isn't it, on all of those bars. Just one more time. Yeah, a nice short G in the first time bar, that crotchet. I think always, you know, it's not, once you've played it, it's unimportant. After that, you don't need to hold it in any way. And then, so going back to that sequence, the crotchets after, you know, it's like what, the third, fourth bar of the trio. So tell me, like, what do you think you can do in terms of shaping it, in terms of phrasing it, given that you're, you know, hopefully going to be in a section of up to eight, who hopefully have some kind of common idea about where it's going. So you were talking about maybe bringing out the rising?
Yeah. Kind of bringing out the first note of each bar, coming away from the second, and then...
Yeah. So when it's... Hang on, I'm just going to move it over here. Which do you think are the most important notes in those bars?
Specific notes or which beat?
Yeah, well, so. Is that what you're thinking? Like. Yeah, so with an with an upbeat. And then after that?
Then I think it's kind of fun to bring out the D and kind of in the kind of the hiccup of suddenly emphasizing the second beat.
It's, and something you can do a little bit, you know, obviously it depends on the conductor, it depends on the the situation. You can slightly lengthen or you can shorten, you know, to help show where you're going to and create some kind of shape and direction and movement. I would agree with you. I'd be And that's the same, isn't it? You're that rising. And I tend to be to get a bit more emphatic as it moves along. And then, and particularly as you're going back into that quaver section. So why don't we play that? Why don't you maybe go from the beginning of the trio, go into that crotchet section. I think you can make, there is a crescendo in the second bar, isn't there, the second full bar. I think you can make more of that. Do you see where I am? Even if it's on the last three notes, you can really go to the G. So, you're familiar with the, you know, it's traditionally there's often a, I exaggerate, there's a little break before, So I think even if it's a very, very small one, what's important is that the B is really strong. You know, I have an accent written in here, I don't know if it's a real one or a, do you have an accent?
I penciled one in.
Perfect. So, we need, it is the downbeat, isn't it? The B is the downbeat, so we do really need to hear that very clearly. And also, because it's in, you know, a terrific scrumfuffle of noise, of notes, you know, so, which is why, you know, I was getting you to do this hammer stroke. The closer to the heel you can be, and maybe even a little bit closer to the bridge, the clearer the sound will be, you know, and hopefully we can hear it, we can distinguish between the notes and the speed of them. Do you want to go again from the beginning of the trio then? Yeah, but still really short.
Right.
Yeah, that crescendo was better, wasn't it? It was good. It really felt like you were going to the G. Yeah. Let's move on a little bit. Maybe the second time bar. Yeah. And so what's your idea about this little section? What do you think? What's important here, and what kinds of shape and movement and phrasing can you do?
Well, it'd probably be a good idea to play the repeated thing differently each time.
Sorry, say that again. A good idea to play the repeated.
The play that bit differently when it repeats either more or less, I guess. and then yeah, and then come down and back up for the four bars of quavers.
Yeah, do you mean down in dynamic?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then grow through that ascending.
Yeah.
Yeah. The challenge there is to make the line understood, I think, because of the speed of the notes. Show me what you mean. So go from the second time bar again, that you know that the G into the F. Great. I mean, if you wanted to, you know, put a little bit of a jiggy on it,
yeah.
Where you have, you know, you're grouping them in threes. I think that's kind of nice, and it because the whole thing is so boom 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 boom, you know, it gives it a little bit of unexpected shape, which is great. Let's move on and do the bit where it gets quieter.
Yeah.
Is that it's after B for me? I don't know what it is. Where it is for you?
Yeah.
Okay. So would you do the just jump in on the G octave somewhere towards the end of that, and then do that section? So the effect is, or needs to be, that, you know, the first one is forte. We don't have anything louder than forte in this whole trio, right? So I think when you're playing it, you will play louder than forte. Everybody does, you know. And so the effect needs to be stepped back, I think, more dramatically.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? So where it says diminuendo, so you have the forte, and then you have a diminuendo, and then it's piano. The next one is piano. Yeah. So I don't know what, you know, your diminuendo needs to go from forte, it needs to start at forte and go to piano, you know, in that bar and a crotchet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I think your piano needs to be much quieter. And again, the challenge is in articulating at that dynamic and at that speed, and playing short notes will help you enormously there. So let's try that with the dynamics. So even just if you do the forte one and then the diminuendo one. Can it be more dramatic, the diminuendo? Yeah, and I know it's terrifically hard over Zoom and it cuts out, it's difficult to know where the extremes of the dynamics really are. I'm sure you're playing as quietly as you can. Are you? Could you play quieter from the piano section onwards? Imagine that you're one of eight in a section, and that,
yeah,
that you know the dynamic of all of you is piano at the most.
Hmm.
Like, so your contribution has to be, you know, kind of an eighth of piano.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just try that, the piano section. Yeah. It's, what do you feel the challenges are there?
Trying to play a bit off the string.
It
gets harder.
Yeah. Trying to articulate it.
Yeah.
In other words, yeah. Does it make a difference where you are in your bow? When you've been playing really loud at the beginning, you're kind of here. aren't you? You're right at the heel.
Yeah.
And then. So you're more kind of. I don't think you necessarily have to be as off the string as you would have been in the louder sections.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's important to keep it short and to keep it kind of controlled, because it can really easily just kind of, you know, free fall. And if you imagine eight people facing the same challenge, it has to be really tight, yeah, in order to be coherent to the listener. Let's try it a tiny bit slower and see if you can get that articulation and shortness, you know, without going as much off the string. Would you call that piano? Yeah, that's like you playing by yourself piano. Now in a section of eight piano. Yeah, it's different, isn't it? Yeah. It feels different. And I think, you know, that same thing.
Yeah.
I exaggerate a little bit, but you can just kind of dig those out. Yeah. Great. It sounds fantastic. Yeah.
Thanks.
Shall we go back to the beginning of the movement?
Oh, yeah.
Great. So what do you think are the most important things at the beginning of this section then? What's going through your mind? What are you focusing on?
Playing smoothly.
Yeah.
And quietly.
Which is harder than it sounds.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if a slightly faster, breathier bow might help, you know, keep the dynamic really quiet, but also give that kind of sense of movement and direction. You want to just try from the beginning? Yeah, so you're doing it on a down. I wouldn't worry, I wouldn't concern myself too much with the notes speaking properly.
Yeah.
It's more important to have a breathtaking dynamic. So it needs to be really super, super quiet, like one hair of the bow. I'm straining to hear you. Is he playing? Is he not? You know, and I think if you've got that, I don't know, can you hear that? Does that come through?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so. You know, in no sense are those notes really speaking properly, but I think that's less important than the effect. And again, you're not just going to be by yourself, you're going to be in a section, so it's the combined sound of that would, I think, be really effective. Yeah. And just try again. Okay, so You started on your bow about there, started about here, and by the time you went back, you'd only got to maybe there.
Okay.
Try using the whole bow, which will make you go faster. Yeah. How does that feel?
Fine.
Does it feel different from what you were doing?
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit easier.
I think that floaty sound is something worth cultivating.
Yeah.
Because it's very useful in an orchestral context. You know, as I say, where you don't particularly need to worry about every note speaking.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know what? I feel like I'm going to go on for ages and you won't get to play your piece. So, do you have any questions about any of this, or are you happy to move on?
Yeah, I can go on.
Okay. So tell us what you're going to play.
The first movement of Bodicini's second bass concerto.
Mm-hmm. So, what do you love about this piece?
Sorry?
What do you love about this piece? Do you like it?
No, yeah, I do. It's very kind of operatic. And there's lots of opportunities for different characters and taking time and getting to feel like a singer.
Yeah, I mean, that's really important, isn't it? The bel canto style. Yeah, I mean, Bottesini is so operatic. It really is singing with your instrument. Yeah, that's really important. And I think everybody's playing Bottesini today. So we have a bit of a Bottesini fest. So, you know, important for everyone to really try and inhabit that world of singing and the drama that comes with that, you know. Anyway, I'm going to stop talking. Why don't you play? play the whole first movement, and then we'll come back and chat.
Thank you.
Character of the piece and the whole thing. So well done, huge well done. Really super. So what do you find, what do you feel that you do well and what do you find challenging?
Specifically right now, it's challenging.
My heart rate's gone down a little bit.
it's weird to play it just in a room with nobody in it at home.
Sure, yeah.
Like it's a masterclass. That's, I found that kind of challenging. But
we'll try and create an atmosphere. We all collectively try and create an atmosphere for you.
I guess it's a challenge to I guess go to the extreme to try and bring something across.
Yeah.
And to sustain phrases.
Yeah.
And not just...
What do you feel that you did well? Because you did a lot of things really well.
I think I got some of the kind of different character changes, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And it was really in tune. You got those, you know, those huge jumps in the cadenza, you got those spot on. Anything else that you did well? okay. Well, do you know what I think? You know, listening to the movement as a whole, I think certainly you can work on your extremes of dynamics. So the piano places, you know, need to be quieter. And I think actually that's kind of where the drama is. Yeah. So you can kind of increase the sense of, I don't know, something's happening, or, you know, the tension. You can really make us sit up and go, oh, what's next? You know, for example, you know, the nasty da 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 da, that bit.
Yeah.
The first time, both times, in fact. But that piano, I think you can really make more. Shall we do that? Do you mind doing it? I know it's really hard. Do you mind doing that? So let's think, where is that? If you went from somewhere like, you know, 82, do we have the same music, I think?
Yeah.
And just, you see the piano, there's no accents or anything on the first four of the group of semiquavers, but that's where the descending line is going, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So I think you can just dun 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 dun. You can bring that out within a very quiet dynamic, just a little, like a little elbow dig.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So where was it? 82 or some, wherever you're comfortable around. Thank you. make it even quieter to start with.
Aura, excuse me, folks, I'm sorry to jump in. We are actually out of time, but if you want to wrap up just in a couple of minutes, Aura, that's absolutely fine.
Okay, perfect.
Sorry to jump in.
Okay, no worries. So just to keep that really, just really tight and really quiet, and then you've got somewhere to go. It doesn't need to be, you know, I'm not saying put accents on all of those notes, you know, equally, but I think you can really build the tension and build the expectation of what's going to happen here. I'm sorry, I took up so much of your time with the Beethoven.
Oh no, it's good, thank you.
We've run out of time, but well done. It sounds really similar. But my last parting words would just be to kind of try and increase the dynamic ranges and the drama.
Right, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Alex, and thank you, Aura. So folks, if you're watching the masterclass, don't forget that we will have a short Q&A session after our third participant. So we would encourage you to submit your questions for Aura via the chat facility on our YouTube channel, Facebook, or wherever you're watching the masterclass. So proceeding, we will have our second participant, Stéphane Pittier. And Stéphane is joining us right now. Hello, Stéphane, and you're very, very welcome. And Stéphane is a third year student with David Whitla at the Cork School of Music. And he's been learning double bass for 16 years, during which he has led such orchestras as the Vienna Youth Orchestra and the National Youth Orchestra of Ireland. And as a soloist, he placed first in the CSM Senior Recital Competition in 2016. So Stéphane, or Steph, as I believe you're commonly known, you're very, very welcome. I'm going to leave you with Aura. After this participant, we'll be taking a very short break, 3 minutes. So we will see you just before that in about 40 minutes. So Aura, Steph, thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Hi, Steph, how's it going?
Good, good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm great. So let's start with the Haydn. You're playing Haydn 88 first
movement. Haydn 88 first movement, yeah.
Great. Why don't you just go for it? And then we'll have a chat. Articulation is really good. I think that's a really good speed. It sounds great. Like, what do you tell me about the piece? What do you like about it? What do you feel you do well? What do you feel? Where are your areas of growth?
I really love Haydn overall. I really, really love the symphonies because there's so much humor and there's some things that kind of really come out of left field, and I always really enjoy that. You never really know what to expect when you're listening to it for the first time.
Yeah.
I think I could probably work on getting a bit more of that humor in, you know, and that probably comes from articulation and from the phrasing and from the direction of everything. So
yeah. And what do you feel you do well?
I think I still am kind of giving it a good shot with the direction. I've put a lot of focus on that.
Okay. So in terms of phrasing, or in terms of kind of movement to
kind of like the rhythmic drive of it.
The drive, yeah, perfect. I was going to say good, great, because people struggle to say what they're happy with and what they've done. We should celebrate. We can do, right? great. Okay. You know, I thought it was really good. I think maybe just a couple of little things, you know, and then we'll get on to your piece, because I don't want to take up your time with this. But you know the section, the kind of chromatic? There's a sport sando, isn't there, on the first?
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt like you could make more of a difference with that. Not that it has to be, you know, it's still Haydn.
Yeah.
It has to be massive. But I think perhaps if you, you know, you can alter slightly what's around it so that it pops out a bit more.
Yeah.
Yeah, could you try that? Maybe from just the bar. Yeah, great. And then, for example, then the next bit is very short. It's got dots. Even though he's gone as far as telling us it's really, we need to play that super short.
Yeah.
Can you play that for me again? Just the da 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 da.
Yeah.
How do you think you could make that articulation sound even shorter?
I think I'm maybe moving too much in the right hand, and I can probably like something just a bit kind of fraction more vertical.
Yeah. So you're playing a spiccato. You're playing off the string. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What happens? What happens if you don't play it off the string? Okay. If you keep it a very short but very controlled and on the string.
Mm-hmm. Like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and what about a bit even closer to the
frog? Yeah.
Yeah. How do you feel about that?
It feels kind of strange. I feel like I'm getting a lot of crunch, kind of.
Yeah, and so what about if you take the I don't know, take the edge off that a little bit. Yeah, I mean that actually comes across very well.
Yeah, it feels a lot cleaner. Yeah,
yeah, it is a bit cleaner, and I think certainly when you have your quavers, keep them really super short. I mean, you can still make little things within that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that's great. Those two tricky bits, you played brilliant. Great, well done. Super. And I know exactly what you mean about the drive and the direction, because I think you did that really well. I think that came across very, very clearly. Yeah, well done. Super. Unless there's anything else that you want to cover, I'd suggest maybe we move on to your piece.
Yeah, that'll be fine.
Yeah. You happen to hear that? So tell us what you're playing.
It's going to be the second movement of the Bottazzini Concerto No. 2 in A minor. So this is the Andante.
We just need to do the third movement, and then we have a performance of the whole thing. He's not, so spoiler.
Yeah, you can play the third movement.
Thank you. It's quite a stamina test, isn't it? Sustaining that, that level.
A little bit out of breath.
Yeah. You're holding your breath. I do that all the time. Hold my breath when I'm playing. Bad. I really enjoyed it. I thought your sound was beautiful, and you seemed really in control of it, which was really nice, really lovely. So tell me, again, the same question. What do you find challenging? What would you like to work on, and how can I help you, and what are you happy with, what do you feel really worked?
I think, again, I've worked a lot on making it sing and finding the lines and where they go and where they end, and I feel like I gave that a good push, but I think I can still work a lot on kind of controlling it more and still finding the line when it's at like the dynamic extremes, and then maybe working particularly on the ends of phrases, making the end of each phrase as satisfying as possible.
I agree with you. I think there are lots of places where you can be a bit more nuanced in terms of the color. You can change the color, you can just create a different kind of feel, a different, because it's not just uniform, right, all the way through. I think a bit more subtle, a bit more kind of shaped. Why don't we go from the beginning and let's see if we can kind of look at some of that. Mm-hmm. Actually, just before you do, just a word about your speed. Mm-hmm. I felt, and this is just my opinion, that there were definitely places where I wanted it to kind of move a bit more. And I wondered if you just took the tempo up a notch.
Yeah.
Too, that might just help with the flow and the movement.
Okay.
So what's going through your head before you play that first note, that first F? What are you thinking about? What are you focusing on?
I'm trying to get the tempo in my head right away, and I'm trying to then just, I'm trying to think of making that F go to the C.
Yeah. So how will you do that? What do you think is the most effective way of joining the F to the C? I mean, thinking it is a really good start. Yeah.
I'm not sure.
What I'd add to that is that I think it's your first note, it's your first entry, mm-hmm. right? So I think there needs to be just something about it that's a little bit, it's still, it's not allowed, we don't even have a dynamic, right? It's espressivo. But I think there needs to be something about it that's, you're kind of making a presence felt and known. So can you just play me that first bar even? So you don't you don't full on vibrate, but you just kind of warm the note. And then what I don't want you to do is do a big kind of bilious swell. And so maybe you just kind of put more of a kind of warm front on the note. Yeah, a million times better. That was really nice. And then, so those semiquavers going up, how are you going to shape them? How are you thinking about that kind of end to that little phraselet within the phrase?
I'm thinking it as really being like it's kind of its own thing.
Yeah.
It's a little bit, and then you have the
Yeah.
To kind of join together and.
Yeah, great. So in that case, I think maybe do more of that.
Mm-hmm.
It's very easy. And I know that we've said it before, the Zoom thing is, it's difficult, you know, to know what's real and what's not. But I think, you know, in general, you can't over-exaggerate dynamics and phrasing and shaping, you know, for it to come through, for people to receive it and to understand what you're, you know, what you're trying to say there. But why don't you play that from the beginning, those two bars? Yeah, great. And then you're going to answer these next two bars.
Yeah.
Go on. So here in bar three, we have accents on those two notes that are not present in the first phrase that you're answering.
I have a different edition. I don't have accents.
Oh, do you? Which edition do you have?
It was an edition that was free online.
Okay. So, okay. Well, then, so there are accents in bar three on the G and the D, and. Then there's a crescendo. Do you have that through the next bar, bar four? Yeah. And do you have a dot on the F sharp and an accent on the G in the second half of the fourth bar?
No.
Okay. So if you even just put that in, that will give you some kind of a shape and a shape within it. Let's go from the. It's, you know, the answer, the third bar. That's nice.
Mm-hmm.
So when I say accent, you know, there's lots of different ways that you can produce an accent. And I think in this case, it's not necessarily a bar, a kind of... It's not one of those, is it? I think... No. Maybe it's more of a like a faster vibrato that then slows, you know? I think that's quite nice. That it's quite a nice kind of phrasing off of the.
Yeah.
So just for bar three? And then you're going through to the next bar, so continuing. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I think don't be frightened to really go somewhere.
Yeah.
With that, yeah. Like, as I was saying about, you know, you can't over exaggerate this stuff. Really, really go, and then really enjoy that. You know, you're coming back. Are you on the G string? I think just schmaltz loveliness. Yeah. perhaps from bar 13, the C, F.
Oh, yeah.
Bar 14, just come away a little bit so that you then have somewhere to go. You can make that a little bit, change the color of it, you know. Yeah. Can you try and convey a sense of kind of delicacy about it, you know? It's not all, like, some of it certainly is pow pow, but yeah, that was much nicer. And I think the last semis there, just keep driving through.
Yeah.
Don't take any time there, just keep it going. Yeah, okay, let's continue. Do you have a little grace note on the dun, 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 dun?
No, I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. I think you can really, really, really go, really go for the top there. And think, you know, in terms of your phrasing, that you're not going to go da 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 da. It's going to be da 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 da. You know, it's it keeps that interest and makes more interesting phrasing shapes, and you know.
Yeah.
Let's just try that one more time, and let's carry on. Don't slow down. Dun, 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 dun. And then you're finished. And then, you know, because that's not a place where you can really take time. And maybe you don't have it, but I have an accent on that top F crotchet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, that's a place that you can make, you know, you can give it some colour and perhaps a faster vibrato.
Yeah. Okay.
Than that. But let's continue. Sorry, I interrupted you. Do you want to do the D1, the next one?
Yep.
Great. So again, I feel like you're slowing down a little bit. I mean, all the schmaltz in the world, but not self-indulgent.
Yeah.
I know you're used to, I'm making you play it slightly faster than you're used to. So that's my fault. I'll take the blame for that. Do you have a piano?
Yeah.
Yeah. Were you doing it?
I was thinking about the accent, and I was trying to. I think I went for a little bit too much.
Yeah. I think the drama is in that piano. You know, you can make it a really beautiful thing, change the colour completely. Let's do that one again, the D1. Mm-hmm. So with the piano. And do you also have accents then at the end? of the next bar on the C, the B natural?
No. It's kind of like an implied
Okay. So from the same place, the D? Top D even more kind of special, and
I think it might just be to kind of vibrate in a bit of a different way, like maybe faster.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. And perhaps, you know, you could think about your bow speed.
Yeah.
And what's happening there, because that's another way that you can make things sound different and create some nuances within it. Yeah, okay. Why don't we do that again and we'll continue and I won't stop you, I promise. Really substantially.
Yeah.
And just try and keep it moving a bit more. I think if you just take that speed up a little notch, it just gives you a bit more opportunity to kind of to flow and to move, you know, with the lines, and especially, you know, so much of it is just up and down, up and down. I mean, you know, that's music, isn't it? Up and down. But do you think, this is a loaded question, how do you feel about the at the end of the, let me show you where I am. Well, I can't demonstrate without giving away what I'm meaning. So the D bar that we went from, the second bar, you have that D to an E and then back to a D. Yeah. So you were playing the E on the G string, I think, weren't you?
Yeah.
And then back up.
Yeah.
How do you feel about having a kind of, you know, an audible slide both ways? I'm trying to be as neutral as I can in my
as in like going out. Like that.
I mean, that's what I heard. I heard a kind of,
I see.
Yeah.
I like it on the way down. I think I could do without it on the way up.
Right, there we are. Yeah, great. I agree. I think I think once is, you know, if you don't over egg the custard.
Yeah.
So once would be nice.
Yeah.
And I think perhaps on the way up rather than the way down. I wonder if you played the E here on the D string.
Yeah. So if I like with the thumb or
yeah, you could, or you can, if you come back with the first finger, that'll give you a little bit of a
and then I kind of slide a bit up the
slightly bilious. I don't know, I think, you know, have a play around with it.
Yeah.
Own time and see what you can come up with. But I definitely think that's a place where you can create a bit more space and less uniformity.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a couple of bars later, when you have an A crotchet, I have a quaver rest before the C crotchet. Do you?
I don't. No. So, so was yours more of a.
Yeah, the gap before the C, and there's an accent on the C, and it's
I see.
Piano.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I would interpret that as a call to action for kind of changing the colour.
Yeah.
You know, I think this and Bostonian in general, like, you know, the accents mean different things to perhaps what we're used to interpreting them, certainly in an orchestral context. And I think vibrato has a really big role today in that, and in changing the colour and making difference and space and shape. Let's move on a bit. I know, I love this bit at the end of my page, so I'd love you to play that.
What's at the end of your page?
It lands, it's before you have a whole bar's rest before dun. So I don't know if you want to go. What about, this is nice, isn't it? From there, somewhere like that?
Sure, yeah.
Just kind of cleaning up a little bit so that when you do slide, it's more, it has more effect. And I'm thinking about that whole sequence. I don't know where it's a good place to go from.
I can go from the maybe the
So you're playing all of that subsequent bar on the G string, aren't you?
Yeah.
I wonder if it might be worth exploring going across the string as a way of not sliding and, you know, being able to kind of articulate and bring in a different kind of feel or colour. Do you want to go from that? Is that the B one? Yeah.
So is it like kind of going... like that?
Yeah. And I think... then that kind of gives you the freedom. If you're not sliding to the note, then the slide is not the thing we hear, but then you can change it and you can make the actual note different in some way.
Okay, yeah.
Special, you know.
Nice to have maybe one slide in one of those.
You're angling for more slides, are you?
Yeah, like I think just like maybe the last one just there, because it's such a
but then, you know, that is the beginning of the crescendo. Do you have that crescendo marked?
Yeah
That's the beginning of the crescendo, and where are you going in that phrase? That's not it's the beginning of something that's going somewhere, isn't it? It's not the destination. So I don't know, I feel that you could save the schmaltziness for the end of the next bar in the beginning, you know, because you've got accents there and you can, and then, like, you know, that's I would never stop anyone doing that. I just think that's why don't you try just that last one, so from the D.
The D to the G sharp.
I just need it. be tempted, and this is just, you know, this is just my opinion, but I would be tempted to make something a bit more special on that top F, because that's the highest note, that's where you go. And then I have accents on the E, next note, and then on the C.
On the C as well, okay.
Yeah, and a diminuendo that starts on the C.
Yeah.
Yeah, so your diminuendo, you can do a lot more.
I see, okay.
Yeah, so really, really come away, and then you have a little bit of space to do that nice crescendo at the end. Mm. Yeah? Just maybe if you can find the D, the high D, and just do the...
From like
I, you know... with your slides. I mean, you know, they're fabulous. Fabulous. There's something in me that doesn't really like that open D if you're playing. But I, you know, I do like that. To not slide back, and also I would say the second bar from where you played, the character of that I feel kind of changes a little bit. It gets a little bit more marcato, with the Joshua rhythm, and you're heading towards those three ascending notes that have, in my part, have accents. Do they? The D, E, and the F.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and you have a crescendo. So I feel like you can kind of change up the articulation a little bit to really drive through that, you know? That's brilliant. I think we're pretty much out of time. So thank you so much. That was really great. Really lovely playing.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Steph. Well done. Lovely playing. And thank you again, Aura. It's always fascinating to hear the inside information on these pieces of music. So thank you very much for that. As we said earlier on, we'll be taking a very short break now. It's just about a 3-minute break. So if you're watching, please don't go anywhere, or please, well, do and come back. And we'll continue in about 3 minutes. And just to remind you that if you have any questions for Aura, please do put them into our comments or chat boxes on our YouTube channel and Facebook pages. Thank you very much. And we will be back with our third and final participant in about 3 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back, everybody, and we're delighted to welcome you back to the third and final participant of this afternoon's masterclass. And we have Jacob Butler. So Jacob, you're very, very welcome. Jacob is a first-year student at Cork School of Music and has been involved in music his entire life. He's been involved in numerous musical courses, such as the National Youth Orchestra of Ireland, Ulster Youth Orchestra, and he started playing double bass at the age of 9. He's loved it ever since and has a huge passion for music and composition as well. Jacob, you're very, very welcome, and we hope you get a lot out of the session and enjoy it. Just to remind people again, if you have any questions for Aura, please submit them via the chat facility on our social media platforms, and we will relay them at the end of this session, which will be followed in approximately 40 minutes by a short Q&A session with Aura. So Aura, Jacob, thank you, and I will see you in about 40 minutes. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Nigel. So hi, Jacob, how are you doing?
Hello, good, how are you?
You all right? Yeah, I'm great. Shall we start with your orchestral excerpt?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, so why don't you tell us what you're playing?
I'm playing an excerpt from the first movement of Mozart's 40th Symphony.
Okay, let's just go for it, shall we? We'll have a chat afterwards. It's hard, right?
Yeah.
It's difficult. So you did really well there, and you kept a really strong sense of pulse, which is great, because you know, the last in orchestra, the last thing you want to be doing is rushing or dragging. You know, it needs to be kind of metronomic. So the same question I've asked everybody: where do you feel you did well? What did you think you did successfully? And how can I help you? What do you think you know you can work on, and what do you want to achieve?
I think, as you said yourself, I think the pulse was good.
Yeah.
I think the phrasing, I think there wasn't much, to be honest. So if you can give me any advice on where to phrase things, that'd be great.
Yeah. That was the thing that jumped out at me, actually. Yeah. So even if we just go back to the beginning, so where do you see that first phrase going, that kind of, what is it, it's a bar and a half, where do you think it goes to, and what are the important notes?
Probably the B's and then the high G.
Okay, so I think that's where we're going, isn't it? We're growing. So what I was hearing, now I'm playing that on the D string, because what I don't want is this. Yeah, this kind of slide, you know, and even if you try not to do a slide, it's hard because there's a distance there to go, right? So I think playing it on the D string kind of helps.
Okay.
A bit cleaner, if you know what I mean. So think more about the downbeats, not the upbeats. And
yeah.
Think of the downbeats phrasing towards the first beat of the last bar of that little phrase. Can you try again? Okay, so can you just play as I did, maybe with your second, if you were you doing 4-2? Is that what you did?
Yeah.
Yeah, so maybe with your second finger on the B, if you could just... question.
Yeah, probably not if you're asking.
There we go. Yeah. I think you can exaggerate a bit. You know, through the medium of Zoom but even in orchestra, if you were in an audition situation, I suppose what it's important to remember is you're behind the instrument. You're behind the sound. So you kind of have to, so you know, in order to be successful in saying what you're saying and what you want to say, you have to exaggerate a bit. Mm. You know, if you think you're doing it, you do it some more, and then you're really doing it. Yeah? Okay. So the same thing? Yeah? And maybe don't vibrate. Just keep it quite kind of clean. Yeah, and more of a sense of growing through it. So... Yeah, I feel like your first note has too much front on the note. It's kind of maybe just come in like you've just opened the door at a party. It's already happening. Just so there's no the shape of the note is slightly boat shaped.
Okay.
And do you know what, if you came down your bow a little bit and you were more like, you see where I am there? Yeah, try that. Yeah, so you still started from here. If you start from here,
yeah, sorry,
it happens. Yeah now with the upbeat, so attacking the note, the front of the note. Just a little gentler, I guess. Just try that, coming down. Yeah, so up, down. Can you make just a very small kind of space? Can you make a bit more space? So it's not da 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 da.
Yeah.
Da 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 da. Yeah, that was much nicer, much nicer. Great. Okay, so why don't we go from the beginning and I won't stop you, continue on.
Okay.
Yeah, head on. You have to be really metronomic and short. But within that, you can make some shapes and you can make some phrases.
Okay.
Yeah. So where do you feel that that goes to? So I'm talking about the, you know, when the quavers, this bit. That bit, where does that go to? Where's the phrase going to?
Just the half the line, is it?
Yeah, just from that continuous quavers. There's like four bars.
Yeah.
Where do you feel the phrase is leading us?
I mean, probably to the B, you know? The B flat, so.
Yeah, exactly. So can you play that again and shape it so that that's really obvious to us?
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. And maybe if you made your crotchets a bit longer, so the B and the G, that would help. So, sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
Just that last bar into the crotchets. But don't take too much time.
Yeah, okay.
but still really go.
Yeah.
Da da dum bum is the important one, isn't it? The G A is really leading us to the to the B flat. Okay. And then continuing on, so it's the same, you know what I'm gonna say, right? It's the same.
Yeah.
So let's clean up. Where were you playing that? Were you playing it on the D string?
Yeah.
And see if you can eliminate that schmaltzy slide.
Yeah.
Plenty of opportunities to do that in Bottesini, but not Mozart. Yeah, that was better, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, and again, I think you can exaggerate a little bit more where you're going to. You did it, but I think you can do it more.
Okay.
Yeah, again?
Very excited, yeah.
Yeah. So just make your E natural softer and lighter. Yeah. So we want... Great. Let's just do a little bit of work on the nasty quavers a bit further on, and then which ones? So we'll go into your piece after that. So why don't you? I mean, the only thing I would say to you, you see the change of the double bar, or you this bit. Yeah. So let's do it a little bit slower and try and make everything really short and keep really rigorously in time.
Yeah, okay.
That's all.
Sorry, can you do that again?
Do you think what notes are important harmonically?
Probably the first of each.
So the descending line, the steps down. And I think don't rush. That's everybody rushes. Don't fall into that trap. Keep it really steady. Really, is it helpful to play it at that speed? Should we do that again?
Okay.
Yeah. I'm hearing every downbow. I'm hearing da 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 in the, you know. I exaggerate a bit for comedic effect, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, I know.
Shape that a little bit. You know, go somewhere with it. Take us somewhere.
Yeah.
From there. Can you hear it? Can you hear those damn bows all the time?
Yeah.
What about if we go? Can you go there? Shape it, and we can get away from that very square.
Yeah.
Kind of, you know, that's what we hear. We're hearing it very.
Yeah.
The beats of the bar. So, if you're happy to move on, do you have any questions, or are you happy to move on to your piece?
I think that's good. Thank you.
Okay, great. So, tell us what you're going to play.
Bartolini's Reverie.
Okay. And what do you love? Do you like this piece?
Yes, I think it's one of my favorites, I think.
Is it? Okay, great. Why? Tell us.
I think it's just very, I don't really know. I suppose it sounds very nice, I suppose, if it's a really simple answer, but.
No. So, I mean, maybe what you're alluding to there is the melody, beautiful.
Yeah.
Melodic line, yeah. Which is, we were, you know, talking about Bartolini. We've been talking about Bartolini all afternoon. But, you know, with Alex, we were talking about this amazing, you know, melodic line and the bel canto style. So it's like you're singing. It really has to feel like you're singing, you know,
yeah.
That's how it has to sound to us. So phrasing is really important.
Mm-hmm.
And sound production. You know, you have to have a really beautiful sound, because, you know, you can't do a beautiful melody justice without this beautiful sound.
Mm.
Anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself. Why don't you just play and then I'll get ahead of myself.
Thank you.
Well done, well done. That was super. It's a lovely piece, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is, it's really beautiful. So again, tell me what you think you do well and where are your challenges? What can I help you with? Start with what you do well.
I'm not really quite sure, to be honest. I'd like to think I do the phrasing very well, but I don't know if I get that across enough when I play.
Okay. And did you hit all the notes?
Not all of them.
Your ratio was quite high, I think, pretty much.
Yeah.
Okay. What about, where do the challenges lie?
Honestly, I think a lot with the bow. I think...
In what sense?
Like, it's hard to phrase everything the way I want to when, like, my bow is not infinitely long, if that makes sense.
So are you saying that you feel your bowing kind of chops up your phrases a bit?
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah, okay, I understand. Anything else?
No, that's all I can think of anyway.
Okay, yeah, cool, great. I felt that sometimes you didn't count the full value of some of the longer held notes.
I might have rushed a little bit.
Yeah, I think you hopped off them a little soon. You know, even places, I think we have the same part, don't we? So like bar 36, that's a crotchet. And then the D, the high D in the next bar, at the end of the next bar, that's a crotchet. And you scooted off that like you were leaving the scene of a crime. but always, and I think your dotted rhythms can be a little crisper.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You tended to kind of take, you know, standardize them a bit, take them closer to a straight quiver. And I think certainly there's lots of scope, lots of room for phrasing and colors and expression, you know?
Mm.
And so, okay, so we'll see, let's go from the beginning and let's see if we can get into that.
Yeah.
So actually, before we start, so the dynamic is marked piano,
mm-hmm.
isn't it? Yeah. But this is your first entry and you're the soloist. So it's a soloist's piano. This is not like a Beethoven 5 piano. Yeah? So what are you thinking of when you are about to play that note? Absolutely nothing.
Maybe. I'm not quite sure.
Okay, what do you think it might be useful to be thinking of?
Like before I play it, kind of have a sort of breath with the bow.
Mm-hmm.
Like breathe in.
Yeah, breathing definitely very important. I think you could be thinking about, certainly you want to set the tempo.
Yes.
Before you start, yeah. So you might just kind of play over that first bar in your head.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then I think, you know, a lot of it is to do with the attack of the bow and the way you're producing that sound, because it needs to be a really beautiful piano. It's a kind of... So... within this kind of lower dynamic range,
yeah,
it still needs to be really beautiful and special. Let's just see if we can create a nicer sound. Not that your sound is horrible, but if we can get something really, you know, mm-hmm. special. Yeah. You need to be really in time. Just for us as listeners to understand rhythmically what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you imagine, you know, you're playing a piece to somebody who doesn't know it, they've never heard it before. They don't know, they have a clue what to expect. So, you know, it's like speaking and persuading someone.
Yeah.
You need to be articulate, you need to speak. It's not going to work if you speak like that. So you need to be aware of where your phrase is going. You know, and you might not start out by shouting. I'm not saying you're shouting, but that's the importance of that, of establishing that really beautiful, quieter, dynamic kind of colour. Yeah? Should we just try again? I feel like you are pulling the last beat of the bar around too much. Where are you going to in that phrase? Or, you know, the phrase lurch within the phrase.
C sharp, is it?
So. Like that? Or more?
Yeah,
so you're going to the D.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think, you know, your vibrato will help as well. If you can create a really nice, I think something that just starts the note, a warmth that starts the note. Can you play that first note again?
Yeah.
Yeah. So to me your vibrato sounds a bit kind of tight.
Yeah, I think it is.
And fast, is it? Do you feel that as well?
Yeah.
Yeah. So perhaps it's something for you to work on, you know, after we've finished up here.
Mm-hmm.
If you can just try and cultivate a freer, slower vibrato. I mean, ideally, vibrato, you should be in control of it in terms of being able to do it fast. Sometimes you need that kind of a fast vibrato, you know, and sometimes you need almost nothing.
Mm.
And sometimes you need a big, blousy kind of puffed sleeve of vibrato, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that's our job to that, and vibrato actually is really hard, and it's really hard to unlearn if you've learnt it already, because it's, you know, people play it automatically, they have a kind of default vibrato that they play all the time, you know. But to be conscious and to be able to really use it as a tool of expression and of colour is really, really useful and really helpful, and will help you tremendously. So I would just, you know, even if you're just, I can't really see what your hand is doing, but as long as you're not doing this rock and roll.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want your hand, this part of your hand, to be kind of moving in parallel with the string. Even if you just take your hand off the string and then put it on the G string, on the fingerboard next to the G string, so you're not actually on the string.
Yeah.
And then if you just move it up and down and you feel nice and free, yeah, and relaxed, and then just make that smaller and smaller until you just get, and still no pressure, you're just nice and relaxed, and maybe even just fingers, not a thumb. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
That motion, I mean, it takes time as well to develop that if you've already got a default
mm-hmm.
one. But that might be something that it was worth your while investing your time in.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Okay, sorry, I got a bit sidetracked there with vibrato. So we were doing, we were talking about the first phrase and how you're going to go to the D, and also how your dotted rhythm is going to be, is not going to come out of time. You're going to keep it in time. So why don't you do that once more? Triplicizing your rhythm, your dotted rhythm. Once more. Yeah, go on, carry on. Of your phrase there?
Probably there.
Yeah, the A. It's an A, isn't it? Yeah. So how are you going to convince us that, how are you going to show us that that's your high point of your phrase?
Gonna crescendo into it.
Yeah. And maybe some more, maybe, you know, if you can put a, a special kind of vibrato or something on that.
Okay.
Then you have another one there, don't you, on the F?
Yeah.
Yeah? Should we try that? Maybe from the D? Or from after the D? That's too sharp.
Sorry.
Yeah, lovely. Again, I think I would keep going forwards until I got to that F. So. Not to take time before that.
Okay.
Yes, yeah, so keep it in time. Is it easy to go from the D? Breaking that slur, I wouldn't keep, you know, keep the slur in because you want to be on a down bow on the A, I think, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's more natural. And try that again. And the same thing there. The same thing there. Don't break that slur. Nicer, isn't it? It has more of a flow to it. Let's carry on. Just listening, I don't think I would be understanding the rhythm in that, in bar nine, because you're taking on the B flat, you're taking a lot of time suddenly, and it's a bit confusing.
Yeah.
It's a bit confusing because we're not expecting it. There's nothing, there's no preparation. I mean, are you meaning to take time there, or is that something that's just happening?
Like a bit of, it's kind of both, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Like, to me, I think it sounds a bit nicer, but maybe it doesn't come across.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you in one sense that it is a kind of slightly strange, unexpected rhythm. And I don't know, so you're playing it in octave, aren't you? If you keep it really strictly in time, it feels a bit rushed.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you're going to take some time, don't just jam on the brakes immediately, you know, slow down a bit first.
Yeah, okay.
You wouldn't go around the corner on your roller skates at full pelt and then come to a dead stop, would you?
You'd go flying.
You'd go flying, yeah. So, how would you sing it? You don't have to sing it if you don't want to, but even in your head, how would you sing that phrase?
Da 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 da.
So you sang that perfectly in time.
Yeah. It ruins my point, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean that was perfectly in time, and you phrased it, and I understood it was communicated really effectively. So, and I think, you know, that's the kind of go-to in Bottesini. If you're struggling with a phrase or something is not articulating, you know, how would I sing it? If you sing it out loud, it makes a lot more sense. So why don't you see if you can recreate what you sang on an instrument.
Okay. Sorry, hang on.
So let's just talk about the bowing there. I think, you know, what happens if you do the bowing that's actually printed, the slurs that are printed?
I don't know how to get the... without breaking it.
Sure. I mean, let's talk about that, because you have a slur and then you have lines underneath, don't you? So you've got lines, tenuto lines, and a slur. So, I mean, I think if you think about your first finger and just squeeze, just try that. So if you think of that first finger, it's just even just try that, the length of the bow. Yeah, that's your stroke. Yeah. So, and I think it's okay. I think it's fine and understandable if you do take a tiny bit of time to make it kind of cogent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So let's try from the, with an up bow, and don't break that slur. So the B flat is...
Oh yeah, sorry.
Yeah, just do that for me. It's getting better, isn't it? I think if you come off the dotted quaver a little sooner. So if you're going to slow, it's going to be in the three up bows.
Mm.
Yeah, and I wonder, so what's the fingering you're doing? Are you doing thumb, one, two, shift?
Two. Three? No, it's thumb, one, two, two.
One, two, two. Okay, what would happen if you did thumb, one, one, three? actually a bit more secure.
Yeah.
So you can have a play around with that at home and see where you are at home. We're all at home. But have a play around with that and see if you can find fingerings and bows that don't interfere with the line, so that you, I think your priority should be facilitating this beautiful melodic line and phrase. Yeah, and so if you can enhance that with your newfound vibrato and bow speed and portato, I think you're well on the way to making a really nice, convincing interpretation.
Well, thank you very much, Aura and Jacob. We are out of time. Thank you for lovely playing, Jacob, and all of your insights, Aura. So that concludes the playing part of our masterclass this afternoon. And I'd like to thank again all of our participants for taking part. And of course, the wonderful Aura Stone for bringing us through this afternoon's masterclass. If I could ask our other participants, if they're there, if they'd just like to switch on their cameras and audio, please. And we will have just a short Q&A session before we finish up. So I think, Alex, you were first to play, so we'll take you first. Do you have any questions remaining that you'd like to ask Aura at this point? I just remind you, you're on mute at the moment.
Yep, thanks. I guess, is there anything surprising or unexpected about the difference between having an orchestral position and going freelance, pleasant or otherwise?
Oh, that's a great question. Yeah, it's like, I don't know, it's like having your pick of the Quality Street box. So you kind of go from, being in an orchestra that, in lots of ways does quite diverse stuff, does contemporary music, does opera, does big symphonic and smaller, stuff. But actually, being out of that situation and being in a situation where you can, I suppose, ideally pick and choose your work. It doesn't always work like that. But just the absolute diversity and the breadth of music that's out there to be played, and chamber music. And I've been doing loads of, well, not now, but I've been doing loads of opera and lots of chamber orchestra stuff. I suppose I would have done just so much big symphonic stuff with the NSO that it was really, it felt like cleansing almost to do smaller stuff and to feel like I was making maybe more of a contribution because you're in a smaller setting. So yeah, good question.
Thank you, Aura. Steph, have you anything that you would like to put to Aura now?
Yeah. I'll just ask the slightly gloomy question of how have you found being a musician by profession during, the last year with everything that's kind of come through it?
Yeah, well, horrendous is the short answer.
I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, you kind of go through, it's a bit of a roller coaster. You go through lots of different, I feel like I've been through all the emotions, sometimes all at the same time. And there were definitely lots of positives that come from this, even reorganizing priorities and figuring out what actually really matters, what's important, where, your time is so precious and where you put it, really where you your intention about how you spend your time. That's definitely a good thing that's come out of it. I mean, I just miss terribly playing with colleagues and in an, orchestra or even the chamber music setting. It's just so hard not to be able to do that. And also another thing, I guess, for me was that I could, in a way, generate my own work. Like Nigel was talking about Classical Kids earlier. So, there's a whole concert series there that I was used to curating and being part of And to be, I find it very hard to be told that you can't do that. I find, yeah, I have a problem being told to do anything, really. But yeah, so I find that really difficult, being told that you can't work in the way that you want to. But you know, this is great, and it's just, I'm happy to be among people, even virtually. yeah, so there are definitely positives.
Thanks, Aura. Jacob, is there anything you'd like to ask Aura?
Just as like someone who's trying to make music their profession, how would you, do you have any advice for, I suppose, getting your name out there?
I think the first thing, I have a couple of pieces of general advice, if I can broaden your question slightly. The first one is about creating some balance in your life. I think it's very easy to, when you're a student, to be totally, you know, focused on practicing and to practice, and that's great, and you absolutely should be doing that. And to devour everything, bass and everything, you know, and that's fantastic. But I do think it's really, really important, and this is something that I wish I had done, perhaps when I was your age, to have to find some kind of exercise or some kind of physical thing that you enjoy doing, you love doing, and make sure that you do that every day or every few days, you know. So whether it's yoga or stretching, even just stretching, you spend so much time sitting, you know, in this position, practicing away. It's really hard on your body. That's one thing I found actually after I left the symphony orchestra, that I felt wrecked. My body just felt wrecked. I didn't feel able to physically do that much playing every day, going in, playing that huge repertoire and playing loud, and, you know. So I think what I was missing was this, you know, a balance of a physical thing, you know, doing some yoga, Pilates, or, you know, running or going to the gym or something. I think everybody needs that balance to counteract what you're doing in the practice room. And I had something else to say, but you were talking about getting your name out there. And I think it feeds into that. I think practice, just practice, and then go and play to people or go do auditions or, you know, I think that's the best way.
Thank you very much. And Aura, just a couple of questions from the public. Well, first of all, there's a comment, not a question. It's a salutation. Jonathan Byrne just wanted to say hi. He says, I did my own with you about 10 years ago, and he hopes that all is very well with you. So there you go. Doing our best to connect people during lockdown. And then Patrick asks, what first attracted you to the double bass? And is this the same thing that you still enjoy about the instrument, or has it changed?
Okay, so I started playing the double bass when I was at school. I was 9, and in England at the time, there were free lessons, free peripatetic lessons. So there was a teacher that came around to all the schools in the area, and there just happened to be a space in the bass class. So I actually didn't really choose it. My best friend wanted to do it and didn't want to do it by herself, so I was made to do it. But what I love about the instrument is, I just love, I mean, you know, this. That. It's just, you know, oh. the fundament, the bottom of everything, you know, the foundation, I think. And it's just the most amazing feeling to be playing an orchestra and that's your role, that's what you're doing. You know, it's like the foundation of the house, you know, with knowing that without what you're doing, everything will just topple down. Most important.
Great, thank you. And then from Kira asks, what are the best editors or editions to work from?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I suppose definitely relevant given today's repertoire. So we were talking about the Bottesini second concerto, and up to this point, I think the York edition is the one that's closest to the manuscript. I think there are 3 manuscripts in Bottesini's hand Definitely, there's one in Parma. I think that's in C minor. So he did, you know, he was a traveling virtuoso. So he needed different kind of different arrangements for different circumstances. So there was a piano version. There was a string quintet version. And then there was, you know, a version in another key. So there's a C minor one and the B minor. So for those who don't know, you know, this piece is, it's written, it's in B minor, but we're playing it in A minor. So it would be the solo tuning, which means you tune, you have solo strings, which are tuned a tone higher than you would have them for orchestra, for anything else. So it kind of, the bass becomes a transposing instrument in that sense. But interestingly, Tom Martin, who is expert on all things Botticini, is just about to bring out a new edition of that concerto. I think he's like literally close to just sending it off. So he went and he looked at the C minor manuscript, which is in Parma, and his edition is based on that. So actually, I'm really excited about seeing that when it comes out, because there are some small differences in articulation, different little, you know, quasi cadenza passages. So that would be really interesting. So thank you for that question, because
Okay, thank you. And I think we've just time for maybe one more question. And this question in, what's the best double bass that you have ever played?
I wish, really, is the answer to that. Gosh, I don't know.
Is there one that stands out or?
No, not really. I don't think I've had the opportunity to play real amazing instruments. And this instrument is made by Tom Martin. This is Tom Martin bass, and I do love it. I love its kind of chocolatey, warm, round sound. You know, I think it's a fantastic instrument. So I haven't really had the impetus to go and try loads of other instruments because I'm still in love with the one I have.
Great, isn't that? Yeah. Instrumental monogamy, the best way to
do it. Yeah.
Well, on that note, Aura, can I just thank you very much again for this super masterclass this afternoon. It's been an absolute pleasure listening to your insights into the music and, of course, also listening to our three participants. So Alex, Jacob and Steph, thank you very much for participating today. We hope that you've enjoyed the session, and we're no doubt going to hear you playing long into the future, and we look forward to that as well. Don't forget about our third and final masterclass in the series, which is also next Thursday, same time, 2:30 p.m. And this is a tuned percussion masterclass with Richard O'Donnell, who is percussionist with the National Symphony Orchestra and also percussion teacher in the Royal Irish Academy of Music. So please do tune into that. And I think we can promise a interesting and varied afternoon. So that's it from us. So thank you very much for tuning in today. Thank you again to Aura and our participants. And we hope to see you again at one of our events very soon, and hopefully back in the concert hall as soon as possible. Thank you.